Hello, I'm Hadrianus, Armchair General, and today we're crushing cities, attacking apartments, brawling barns, and swatting spires. This is Monsterpocalypse. Okay, doesn't look like much, but trust me, this game is awesome. It has everything you would ever want from a kaiju movie.
Oh, really? I think you're gonna have to provide some proof of that statement.
If I do, will you let me be?
Of course.
Fine.
Good! Now, how many Toho kaiju are there?
Easy. 31.
What were the eras the Godzilla movies were split into?
Huh. There was the Showa era, Heisei era, and the Millennium, so 3.
Name all the monsters shown in the Gamera series.
Well, there was Gamera, of course. Barugon, Gyaos, Virus, Guiren, Jigger, and Zigra. Legion as well. And Iris. And Zetus.
What were the origins of Ghidorah?
Which one?
All of them, of course.
Well, we had the original Ghidorah, which was a space monster with no clear backstory. Then there was King Ghidorah, which was made from three mutant little freaky baby pet things called Dorats, which were combined by radiation, which was meant to create Godzilla, but it was time travel. Then there was GMK, where King Ghidorah was a great ancient guardian of the Earth, along with Mothra and Baragon, which was weird. And there was also the Kaiser Ghidorah from Godzilla Final Wars.
Damn it. Fine. But one more slip up, and I'll be back.
Anyway, let's move on. Now, Monsterpocalypse, or as I will be referring to it as Bonpok, is set in our world some undefined amount of years in the future. A whole host of monsters, aliens, and beasties have awoken or arrived on Earth and proceeded to wreck all of humanity's cities. This makes all the governments of the world unite and create GOD, the Globally United Advanced Research and Defense.
These are the only unambiguously good guys in the whole setting. They use tanks and giant robots to protect humanity from radicals, fiends, destroyers, invaders, and collaborators.
Next up are the Pterosaurs.
The Godzilla faction. Big dinosaurs trampling their opponents underfoot, seeking to feast on pollution. They are supported by an eco-terrorist group known as Green Fury.
Representing the fiend agenda of the game, we have the Lords of Cthulhu. No, Cthulhu.
Because that would be copyright infringement. But yeah, they're all squid-faced beasties who come from another dimension and drive their worshippers mad. Now, the Planet Eaters are bizarre alien beings who are interested only in destroying our world, for no other reason than... evil? As for the Martian Menace, think War of the Worlds. Tripods, flying saucers, crazy Martians trying to conquer Earth for its resources. And finally, we have the Shadow Sun Syndicate. Scientifically engineered ninjas who can grow to the size of the monsters. Like Jet Jaguar.
There are other factions in the game, of course, but I'm focusing on those first six that came in Monsterpocalypse Rise, as the first set. This is because Privateer Press have recently released a two-player starter set, which lets you and a friend pretty much start playing immediately. Now, the entire game is written in the greatest tradition of monster movies. It's silly, has little plots, the monsters range from awesome to ridiculous, And that's just the way we love it. So the point of the game is for you to defeat your opponent's monster, not only using your own monster, but also, well, not really an army, but a supporting cast of tanks, smaller beasties, things that easily get killed by the larger monsters to establish how badass they are.
The game is played on the playmat, which is broken down into a grid to facilitate movement and the placement of structures. There are many different mats available, but you have to buy them separately in special building booster packs. The same goes for monsters and units, but more on that later. Now, Monpok uses three special different types of dice. Action dice, boost dice, and power dice. Action dice are the most commonly used and are comprised of three misses, two strikes, and a super strike. You spend action dice to spawn units, make models move, make attacks, and use special actions. Every time you make an attack, you must roll one or more action dice, up to the model's melee or range statistics, and get more total hits than the target's defense.
There are 10 action dice per player, and during the game, these will move from the unit pool to the monster pool. When spending dice during the unit turn, they are placed in the monster pool, and vice versa. You begin the game with all your dice in your unit pool, so the first turn of each game will always be a unit turn.
Spending dice involves spawning units, moving them, and attacking. A unit's cost varies according to its nature, but often the cost is either 1 or 2 dice per little critter or tank. Movement costs 1 dice per unit, allowing it to move the number of squares as its move stat allows. Then whatever dice you have left can be spent on attacks. The Brawl and Blast, melee and range attacks respectively, have a number listed. This is the maximum amount of dice you may roll for an attack of such nature. You can only perform 1 attack per turn per unit. Monsters function in the same way. You spend 1 dice to move them, then a number of dice equal to their Brawl or Blast statistics. You can also spend action dice to step, move 1 square per dice before or after movement. This does not count as your movement, which is critical when setting up some power attacks. More on those later.
Boost dice are blue. These represent how good some things are at certain types of attacks, so like tanks are good at shooting and the large dinosaurs are better at melee. These have a much higher ratio of hits to misses, and they're free to roll. They don't cost you anything, and most of the time, well, you will always roll them because they increase your chances of hitting and damaging.
Now, the red dice are your action dice. You start the game without any of these, and have to generate them by capturing power zones, destroying buildings, securing buildings, or destroying units. These dice can only be used by your monster, in the same way as boost dice, with a difference that there is no limit to the amount of power dice you may roll, except, of course, the amount you have actually generated. Red dice must also be spent to allow your monster to perform power attacks. These are, well, wrestling moves, really. Slams, throws, and suplexes, the works. Most of these require only 1 red dice to be spent, at which point you make a normal brawl roll to see if the enemy is hit. Throws are special since the distance the opposing monster is thrown is equal to the amount of power dice you spend to pull the throw off. So the maximum distance you can throw an opposing monster is 10 squares.
Pretty much it. Player A takes a unit turn, player B takes a unit turn, player A takes a monster turn, player B takes a monster turn. And this goes on until one player wins. Of course, there are some tricks you can play with, you know, switching around the way you activate your monsters and your units, but I'll let you find that out for yourselves. Now, the miniatures themselves aren't the sort of thing you'd be used to as a wargamer. They're not relatively high quality, but as a trade-off, they are ridiculously sturdy. This makes the game ideal for playing with younger children as an introduction to wargaming as a hobby, since, you know, you can pick up one of these things and throw it across the room without any damage, and they come pre-painted and there's no need for assembly.
The game is slightly toyish. Many people have repainted their monsters and units to make them more like miniatures and less like playing pieces. There is a good variety of factions and associated models, each easily recognizable thanks to having a unique aesthetic.
Also, this game is marketed as a collectible miniatures game, which means you get more units and monsters in the same way you get more magic cards. Booster packs.
There are three kinds, one for monsters, one for units, and one for maps. You will always get random miniatures from the first two packs, making collecting a single faction infuriating, unless you're willing to jump onto eBay or happen to be part of a gaming group with a fair amount of Monpok players willing to trade with you. The building and map packs come in one single pack with one building and two playmats, and you always know the contents of those.
Then again, Property Press has announced that they're going to be releasing faction boxes, so the collectible issue is pretty much going to go out the window and no longer be an issue. Don't know when that's happening though, so until they do, introduce this change, it'll stay. So to sum up, a good introduction to wargaming with nice rules, which are relatively simple. However, just the sheer fun factor means that this appeals to everyone of all ages, especially if you grew up on the old monster movies and you just want to destroy an entire city with a really cool or really silly monster.